good afternoon. So we are going to start off with the most important part of the course, namely optimization. So it has taken 2 months for us to come to this stage. The first 2 months you were getting prepared to study optimization. So before optimization you needed to know simulation, regression and modeling. Of course I assume that you know some modeling. So wherever possible, if time permits, I keep giving some ideas about modeling of thermal equipment and so on. So this is for the next 8 weeks, we'll look at optimization, the various techniques involved and so on. So this class will be an introductory class where we'll just look at some flow chart connected to the optimization, what this process is all about, how can we mathematically define, how can we mathematically rather construct or propose an optimization problem and so on. So what is optimization? Mathematically, what is optimization? So mathematically, it's mathematically the process of finding conditions that give the maximum or minimum values of a function. So we say so we want to extremize, we want to find an extremum. The extremum is a more general term which includes both the maximum and minimum. Of course simultaneously we cannot get maximum minimum to the same function. So in some cases it could represent the maximum, some cases it could represent the minimum. So it is so obvious, right? So as far as engineering is concerned, you would expect that every engineer will optimize whatever be the design. After proposing a design you want to optimize, right? So therefore can we say that it is always expected from engineers but often not done, correct? Why? It seems perfectly logical, right? You want to, once you design something, a power plant or something, you want to optimize it. You want to optimize your engine, you want to optimize your clutch, you want to optimize your brake, you want to optimize your time, you want to, right? Everybody wants to optimize, right? It is always expected from engineers but often we do not do it. Why? Cost benefit. Okay, there is something called cost benefit. In some, in very very large engineering projects sometimes it may not be possible, it may not be possible for you to bring it down to a mathematical form and write the set of constraints and so on. Or even if you're able to do so, it is so mathematically complex, so intimidating that it is not possible for you to optimize. The second thing is there are situations where it is possible for you to optimize but because of the time and the effort, okay, involved in doing an optimization, you do not want that. You are more often than not you are satisfied by a design that works reasonably well. That is, it satisfies all the performance requirements. A pump and piping system which will pump the water, the assignment which you did, that is sufficient, okay, you do not want for whatever reason, okay. And the third may be an absolute lack of knowledge on your part. You do not know there is a field called optimization, people have worked, the techniques available, so you do not know, so you say that it is not required. That is one point, that is one. Then there are other projects in which it is not worth doing optimization because, okay, for example already something has reached a saturation, the electrical motor efficiency is 98% or 99%. A copper or aluminium fin efficiency is 98% or 99%. That is it, you be done with it, you are happy, I mean it is not required. So, for certain cases, the additional time and effort and money you put in into the optimization effort is not justified. So, for various reasons, optimization is not done. But this is a course on optimization. So, I will say that for all problems, optimization has to be done and all that. But that is far, far from truth. For all problems, optimization is not required. Therefore, when you are talking about optimization techniques, we are talking only about those problems for which optimization is meaningful. Okay. So, there is a large class of problems where optimization will be meaningful, right. For example, you want to design an aircraft, you certainly want to reduce the weight. Okay, the 787 Dreamliner is coming with a lot of plastic now, right. Okay. The 747-400, the Boeing Jumbo, which had 4 engines, is no longer the benchmark. Okay. So, you are able to fly non-stop 16 hours, Bombay to New York. I missed 1 week of optimization event, right. I took a non-stop flight Bombay to New York, 16 hours, 13,000 kilometers, 2 engines. It is highly risky in my view. It just one bird has to get into each of the engines. Okay. So, now 747-400, that redundancy 4 engines is not required, but even now for VIP movement 777 is banned, right. So, the president of India or US or whichever country, or the Prime Minister of UK, he or she has to necessarily use a 4 engine aircraft for safety purposes. But however, for commercial aviation, the 2 engine aircraft is certified now. So, there is something called ETOPS, right. I told you about this. There is something called ETOPS, Extended Twin Engine Operating Performance Standard. So, the 777 is now certified ETOPS of 180 minutes. So long as you are 180 minutes from the nearest airport, you can fly anywhere. So, because of this 777, lot of rescue airports have come up all over the world. Because you are doing the 777, you cannot cross the Atlantic directly because there are no rescue airport. So, you take the polar route. So, all they will go north of Germany, they will go to Scandinavia, and then they will just touch. They will just go south of Iceland, so that Reykjavik airport is 3 hours, then they will go south of Greenland, so that there is 3 hours green, some airport in Greenland, then they will touch Canada, then Newfoundland, Labrador, all this, and then they will come down Boston, and then they will go to New Washington or New York. That is the route they are taking. Okay. So, it is a highly optimized aircraft, but it saves so much of fuel compared to the 747-400, right. So, it is a very optimized design. So, that is going to be the future. So, Boeing has closed the 747-400, I mean 4 engine aircraft will no longer be produced. So, they will try to optimize this further and further, and the 777 or its cousins will become the benchmark, right. Therefore, there are certain, so aircraft you really want to optimize, racing cars you want to optimize. Okay. So, there are wide variety of engineering problems where it is non-negotiable you want to optimize. Okay. Let us look at some examples. Yeah, you just list down. You just keep telling me if it is okay, I will list it down. You just say maximize. I'll start with maximum efficiency of a power plant. Then don't get stuck to power plants, we are in mechanical, anything else. Maximum which efficiency? Okay, maximum efficiency of an IC engine. Yeah, maximum COP. Maximization of which problem? Okay. Manufacturing for minimum cost, minimizing cost of manufacturing. optimal scheduling for a machine, correct? For a machine on which several jobs can be done, several different types of job. So we can, it is, the list is endless. So this is representative. This gives you a good idea of the variety of optimization problems that occur in mechanical engineering, chemical engineering. Reaction engineering, give me, can you get more specific? Optimum product mix or product mix from a fractionating column, right? Fractionating column at various points, different products come out, right? In a petroleum refinery, I'll say. Electrical engineering. Minimizing power consumption is not the, is expected from the consumer. Minimizing transmission losses. What do they call it technically? What is it called? T&D loss. Transmission and distribution loss. In IIT, electronics is also under electrical, so you can list something in electronics. Faster communication between nodes in a communication network, okay? Minimizing. In computer engineering, we are talking about hyper threading, is it? Let's look at some down to earth examples. Maximizing processor speed, okay? Reducing cost. Minimizing memory, but we can say maximizing memory, okay? Maximizing memory storage, whatever. So the external hard disk now 1 terabyte is available, is it? Loosely, freely. 1 terabyte is available. Okay, when I started, when I was doing engineering, it was 640 KB RAM. Okay, they are only monochrome monitors. Okay, now we got, so these are all eclectically chosen examples from various fields. So you know that there is no shortage of optimization problem. You can easily make a career out of optimization. There is no problem, right? So if you are an optimization expert, you can be a consultant and ask people to give their problems, and if you are good, you will give a good solution to the problem, right? Now, before getting into the formalism of how to write the objective function, constraints and all this, let's take an example. So, in this course, I am trying to prefer that route. First, we'll work out an example, and then we look at the theory from the example. Problem number. Problem number 20. Okay, please take this problem down. An ethylene refining plant. an ethylene refining plant receives 500 kg per hour of pure ethylene. And refines it, what is the point in refining? 50% pure. Okay, so 50% pure ethylene. Chemical formula is correct, isn't it? C2H2 is what? C2H6. Good. Okay. Chemistry 101. Okay. So an ethylene refining plant receives 500 kg of. But what is the IUPAC name? An ethylene refining plant receives 500 kg of 50% pure ethylene and refines it into two types of output, 1 and 2. Okay. So type 1 has 90% purity, type 2 has 70% purity. Okay. The raw material cost is rupees 40 per kilogram. Type 1 has a purity of 90%, while type 2 has a purity of 70%. The raw material cost is rupees 40 per kilogram, and the selling price type 1 is 200 per kg, type 2 is rupees. Sindhil, are these values okay? How much are you buying from the market ethylene? You are not working with ethylene. So he is doing PhD in combustion. So you, but I have seen some ethylene cylinders in the lab. I bought some ethylene recently for the Rankine cycle power plant. I think it is a ballpark value. It's okay. It should be around 200-250 per kg. Packaging facilities allow a maximum of packaging facilities allow a maximum of 200 kg per hour of type 1. Packaging facilities allow a maximum of 200 kg per hour of type 1 and 225 kg per hour of type 2. So the transportation cost is type 1. Rupees 8 per kg and type 2 is rupees 16 per kg. The transportation cost is rupees 8 per kg for type 1 and 16 per kg for type 2. And the total transportation cost cannot exceed rupees 4000. The total transportation cost or should not exceed rupees 4000. Okay. 4000. Okay. Cannot be 4000 per kg. Is 4000. Okay. Set up the optimization problem to maximize the profit. set up the optimization problem to maximize the profit. Set up the optimization problem to maximize the profit and state all the constraints. And state all the constraints. One, do not try to solve the optimization problem. Two, let mass flow rates of 1 and 2 be x1 and x2 respectively. I want uniformity. Okay. To ensure uniformity, declare the mass flow rates of types 1 and 2 as x1 and x2 respectively. Yeah, so people who miss some critical data can look at the screen, fill up those critical data, and please start writing out the objective function, that is, write out the equation for the profit, and whatever constraints come to your mind or whatever constraints you can make out of this problem, please write out. Then I will spell out the constraints and I tell you where there is scope for optimization in this problem. Okay. So you are approaching the problem as a novice now, as somebody who does not know optimization. Done? What?
Is it necessary that we have to always take 500 kg per hour, or
it cannot exceed 500 kg per hour. It cannot exceed 500. You can dump certain things or let it remain. Okay.
No sir, would I be paying the raw material cost for 500 kg?
No, but it is, sometimes it is possible that it doesn't come out, and so.
It's a kilogram of product.
Because there is no way to check that, no, the product finally. Is everybody through? I will give you a couple of minutes, then we will start setting up the problem. So profit. So what is profit? No. Leave that. Why do you want to complicate? Okay, we'll write 200. Now let us first write the 200 x1. Plus 120 minus 40 into 500. Okay, then minus.
So 40 into 10 by 6.
Which one? Here.
Sir, 40 into.
Anyway, 500 is entering. That's all. But we cannot sell it again. I mean, it's gone. It is required for the process. 500 into 45 is your investment. If you are not able to get that output, is your funeral. You have spent already 500 into 40. Okay, don't try to make it x1 plus x2 into all that. Okay, leave it. Then transportation cost, somebody. Minus. This, you are saying 192 x1 for this, or?
I included the 40 into.
That's all right.
In that case, you don't have to include that because the optimization constant will come.
But in the final thing, it will come. For deciding where the optimum occurs, it won't come. But I want to write the correct expression. Is that okay? So you want to maximize this?
Yeah.
Okay. So max of this. So 192 minus 20,000 is it? Okay, but no optimization problem comes without constraint. Otherwise, I can put x1 equal to infinity, x2 equal to infinity. It's simply not possible. Just as I say, economics is all about limited resources, unlimited wants. Okay, economics is all about limited resources and unlimited wants. Okay, so like this, we cannot keep x1, x2 infinity. I mean, so the constraints are coming, right? So, constraints. First is mass balance. Mass balance. Mass balance. 0.9. X1. Less than equal to 250. It shall not exceed 250. Okay, it shall not exceed 250. So mass balance is an inviolable constraint. Okay, conservation of mass. Next, transportation. Right. There is a constraint on that. No, you don't do too much research into this. So 8x1 plus 16x2. Less than equal to there are some constraints arising out of other things. So these are basically called bounds for variables. You have to set limits on variables. Everything cannot be allowed to freely float. Okay, bounds for variables. No, left hand side is what? Yeah, it will be cost per hour. You want me to change it now? We'll change it. Is it okay? Anyway, it is going outside, right? This one, these lectures. So, transmission losses should not be there. Okay. So, bounds for variables x1 what is that? So you're happy, is that all? Non-negativity constraints. You can't produce minus 40 kg of type 1 and all that. Okay, there are some non-negativity constraints. It has to be both x1 x2 have to be positive. Okay, so if you write out an optimization problem like this, this is basically called the formulation of an optimization problem. From the problem statement, which is given in English along with some values, you are putting down, you are putting this down in a mathematical form. We are so fortunate that the objective function and the constraints are all linear, but this is a highly non-linear world. Okay, as thermal engineers, the easiest thing is basically T⁴ minus T⁴. Radiation is non-linear. So many things are non-linear. However, if in manufacturing, in job allocation, machine allocation, job allocation problem and traveling salesman problem, your management process will tell you reload a long list of problems where the objective function and the constraints are linear. So there is a special field, there is a special class of problems which can be addressed by using some special techniques, is called LP, linear programming. We will look at the graphical method of solving linear programming towards the end of this course. Then there is a big X simplex method, artificial variables, slack variables, primal, dual problem. So there are so many, you can 45 hours you can have a course in linear programming, advanced linear programming, non-linear programming and so on. So basically suffice it to say that you construct optimization problem like this and then choose an appropriate technique and solve. Is it possible for us to plot the constraints on a graph sheet? It is possible. Now we'll try to have a qualitative plot, though it will take lot of time if you get into Excel. Now we will get an idea of what is the region we are talking about. So so 0.9 x1 plus 0.7 x2 is 250. What is this? This is x1 plus x2, 2x2, 500, right? So I will take up to 500 in steps of 100. Will that be all right? Okay. So x1 is less than 200, so we can plot that. So this is x1 equal to, correct, you are looking at this. x2 225, this 250. So now we have to plot two more constraints, right? So this transportation is, when x2 is 0, x1 is 500, so 500 0 is a point, right? I will take this pink chalk. So 500 0 is a point, then when x1 is 0 it is 250, yeah, correct. So this is a point. Now we can connect these two. We'll draw like this. I'm shading that region which is less than or equal to, right? I'm shading what is called the feasible region, right? So this is basically this is the transportation cost constraint. So what is this prof? Mass balance that you have to tell me. When x2 is 0, x1 is 277. Okay. Then when x2 is 0, x1 is 0, is it? 357. Okay. All right. So So now what is our feasible region? Is there some other color chalk? How do you do that now? Okay, we'll use this. Correct? Okay, so this fellow is called the feasible region. Okay. What is the revelation here? No, it is linear, all that is. What is the revelation here? Objective function is dummy, man, so far. So far the objective function is a dummy. The feasible region is completely decided only by the constraints. Now we have to see in this feasible region which point or which points will maximize your objective. In certain cases it is possible that the feasible region will just reduce to a point. Then basically you have to close your pen, notebook and then go home. That means they themselves decided the final solution. Okay, that means the number of constraints is equal to the number of variables and so on. Therefore, the constraints themselves have the set of, if you have a set of simultaneous equations and the constraints you solve, there is a solution and that is, that is it. Whether it is optimum or not, you do not know, that is the only solution available. And far worse, if the number of constraints is more than the variables, it is over determined, you cannot solve at all. So, where is the key? I mean, what holds the key? The constraints hold the key to the optimization problem, okay. That is very, very important, right. Now whatever we have, so now there are various techniques available. Now you can plot this and find out where it cuts and where the prof for, therefore that is called the graphical method of linear programming. We will revisit this problem towards the end of the semester. But the point I wanted to convey was each of the points within this feasible region is a valid solution to the problem in that it will not violate any of the constraints. But each of these points is not equally desirable because each of these points will result in a different value of the profit. Are you getting the point? Therefore, now we will have to develop an optimization algorithm which will help you to find out which of these points within this feasible region maximizes the Y. Okay, that is the technique for solving the optimization problem after you have formulated it like this. All right. Now we can give a general representation. So max maximize or minimize, y is a function of x1 to xn where n is the number of variables. Subject to, so this is called the objective function. What is your objective? In US they frequently use the term figure of merit, the same as objective. What is a figure of merit? That is the objective function. Subject to, okay, phi 1 equal to phi 1 of is equal to 0, like that. M constraints, M should always be less than or equal to N. What are these constraints? Equality constraints. We didn't have any equality constraint in this problem. When do equality constraints arise? Equality constraints arise when you have to satisfy the basic laws of nature, the law of conservation of mass. Suppose you say exactly this mass has to be satisfied, no mass can be stored within, then 0.9 x1 plus 0.7 x2 equal to 250 you would have put. So if you want to satisfy the law of conservation of mass, law of conservation of momentum, law of conservation of energy, if you want to satisfy all these, invariably you will get an equality constraint. However, when you say that the maximum temperature of the chip, the maximum temperature of the laptop should not exceed 70 degrees, you will say T less than or equal to 70. Correct? So equality constraints arise when the physical laws of nature have to be satisfied. Inequality constraints basically arise from restrictions or limitations on the possible values for certain parameters because of safety and other reasons. Some people would like to treat equality constraints also as inequality constraints. If x equal to 5, they will say x is less than or equal to 6, x is greater than or equal to 4. They will break it down into two inequality and proceed. I do not do that, but if you read some books, particularly machine design people who are practicing optimization will try to, because a equality constraint is a pain, it is very difficult to handle. Therefore, you can sometimes it is possible, but there you are talking about discrete optimization, you are only talking about 4, 5, 6, you are not talking about 4.4, 5.2, 5.2. If you are having such a integer optimization and so on, then it is possible to do some clever thing like that. Okay. Inequality constraints, psi 1 less than or equal to L 1, psi r okay. So finally you have non-negativity constraints. X1 less than some L, everything you use, man. Tell me some symbol. P, okay. P1 and so on, Xn. Don't think that should always be, x1 is greater than or equal to 0. Finally, you have bounds. What did you tell me? P, M is less than M1, M we already used. No, this is only non-negativity. Apart from that, there could be bounds. We have already done that. It comes under this. Okay, leave it. So you can say that the bounds also come under this. You can write the x1 is less than, or don't think that you cannot, it will always be less than or equal to, it can also be greater than or equal to. Okay. Now, so this is a general way you formulate an optimization problem. Here you need not have only linear relation, you can have tan, hyperbolic, exponential, logarithmic, whatever, okay. And to get and solving this may be very, very difficult. This may involve, for example, to get one solution, you may have to do a finite element simulation or a fluent software or whatever to do each of this. It need not be so simple and trivial like this 0.9 x1 plus 2 x2 and all that. So, it may involve each solution, you may have to work very hard. Now, some properties which this satisfies, I will close with this another couple of minutes. max of a plus y1 where a is a constant can be written as a plus max of y1, correct? You don't have to optimize this, you just optimize this and finally don't forget to add the a, okay? Number 1. Max of y1 is min of minus y1. So this basically called the duality principle, right? In genetic algorithms also, there is a special optimization technique. Maximizing y, we also say minimizing y, we also say maximizing 1 by y. That is also possible. Okay? So now, in general, for a two variable problem, this is the feasible domain. And this could be the optimum, for example. So the two very key ideas in optimization are as follows. The two very key ideas in optimization are, number one, the constraints allow you to explore the solution space. The constraints themselves do not decide the final solution. The constraints themselves do not decide the values of all the variables. If the constraints themselves decide all the variables, all the values of x1 to xn, there is nothing you can do. So the first point is the constraints do not, they bind, the constraints bind the values, but they give freedom for us to play around with the variables, number 1. Number 2, where does the smartness lie? The smartness lies in trying to get this global optimum or optimum without working out the value of y for each of the points within the feasible domain. First, there is a feasible domain in which you have got the choice. There are so many solutions, all of which are not equally desirable. Therefore, the constraints allow you some breathing space, you can breathe. But in doing so, you do not foolishly and exhaustively search all the points. So therefore, there is a need to develop appropriate optimization techniques to obtain the optimum, which you can verify otherwise, without having to exhaustively search all possible combinations of variables which satisfy all the constraints. There lies the key in developing a successful optimization algorithm. Alright, so we will close here. So in the next class, we hopefully will start with Lagrange multipliers, the first and foremost technique, calculus based optimization technique.